slaying, I think I'd be safe in saying that over the next hill we'll be home. It's a straight and narrow highway with no detours and no byways, and over the next hill we'll be home. From the prophets I've been hearing, I would say the end is nearing, for I see familiar landmarks all along. By the dreams that I've been dreaming, there will come a great redeeming, and over the next hill we'll be home.
It's good to be back in service today, back at Mount Zion, and I want to just talk to you for just a minute before we get into the message this morning. I know that the governor changed some of the orders and some of the restrictions this week, and I know we've got a lot of people wanting to know when we're coming back to church and what we're going to do and what things are going to look like. And I know some churches are going back this morning, and we met with the deacons yesterday, and I've been trying to pray about it this week and try to find the right direction to go. And this I don't take lightly. I hope y'all know that. But I miss you. I miss being in church. I miss having fellowship together and worship together. And it just seems like we're so disconnected right now. And I don't want the church to take a step back, but I don't, anytime you're not able to assemble together, the church is going to take a little bit of a step back, obviously. We're just not here to strengthen one another. And so what we talked about doing and the direction we're going to try to take is next Sunday, and for the next few Sundays after that, at least through the third Sunday in May, so for the next three Sundays after today, we're going to attempt to have a drive-in service where we'll broadcast from the front porch. You'll come, stay in your car. We'll have a PA system set up so you can hear. And we'll still do the live Facebook stream. We'll still let that go on. And you can watch on Facebook. You can watch on YouTube, the recording if you want to. But we're going to try a drive-in service next Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. The following Sunday after that, obviously, is Mother's Day, and then the Sunday after that is our homecoming, usually, and our communion service on Sunday evening. And the deacons and I, we didn't want to have a service and then have to call the services off and go back to Facebook. We just don't have a good way right now in the church to separate and stay 6 feet apart. So we may need, we've got to work on some things, and we're just not ready to do that logistically. So we are going to try the drive-in service next Sunday. And all of this, I want you to know, I'm conflicted over it. It bothers me. I want to do the right thing. Maybe we shouldn't have called services off at all. I know there's a lot of politics mixed in with all this that's going on. I believe there's as much politics in the news we're hearing as there is medical science. That worries me. That bothers me. I know in the past the church has faced great trials of affliction. They kept going, and I don't want to endanger anybody. At the same time, I want to do what's right by the word and by the will of God. So I'm very conflicted. I desire your prayers this morning. I'd love to be back in church with you. I'd love to say that God's going to take care of us, and if we'll have faith, that we'll all be safe, even if we congregate together. But at the same time, I also know that one of the greatest spreads occurred in South Georgia at a gathering at a funeral in a church. And I'm not going to say those people didn't have faith. I'm not their judge. I don't know why that came about the way that it did. It's a great trial that we're in right now. And I pray the best for all of God's churches today, whether they're having a Facebook live broadcast, a drive-in service, or whether they're attempting to go back limitedly this morning and have no contact and things like that. So I'm very conflicted this morning and very worried about what the direction is and what to do. Right now, we've decided to postpone our homecoming service and our communion service to the second Sunday in June. So we'll look at it then. Hopefully by the middle of May, we'll have some clear direction on whether or not these easing of restrictions have made things better, made things worse, stayed the same, or whatever. And we can make some better informed decisions about that. Continue to live stream this Facebook recording and continue to pray for the church, pray for one another, keep checking on one another. I've got several prayer requests this morning I want to make. To you, I want to ask you to remember Sister Shelley Leslie's uncle this morning. Remember Jack and Jeanette Dockery. I want to ask you to remember Larry Forster this morning. Got a message this morning that they were taking him to the hospital, having difficulty breathing yesterday. So be much in prayer for Brother Larry Forster, dear man of God, and we want you to be lifting him up in prayer. I mentioned Jack and Jeanette Dockery. Continue to remember them. Remember all the lost. Remember those that are not able to come to church. And remember the elderly in our church. I miss fellowshipping with all of you. I'm just torn. My heart's broke this morning over all this that's going on. It's been that way for some time, but it feels especially burdened this morning. If you have your Bible and you'd like to read with us, we'll try to bring a message to you this morning that God laid on our heart maybe Wednesday or Thursday. We've been trying to do a Bible study and follow along every day with Brother Michael Wilkes over at Center Baptist Church in White County. And somewhere during the week, something in that Bible study, and it's a study on prayer, piqued my interest, and God began to stir in my heart this week. So I want you to turn to Mark chapter number 1, the first chapter in the book of Mark, and we want to try to bring a message to you this morning and look at several places in the New Testament. And we're going to probably stay in the New Testament today, and hopefully everything's coming through. We won't have any technology problems this morning. Before we read, let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. So bow your heads with me while we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, God, with in a strait betwixt two, God, having a desire, God, to be with our church family, having a desire, dear God, to worship with them, and God, at the same time, maintain safety for and the health of all of our members, God. And we don't know what to do. We don't know what's best. God, our hearts are heavy. Our hearts are breaking this morning. We've got needs all over our community. We need to go out and visit some people, God. We ask you, Father, that you'd be with Patsy and be with Sister Pearl, God, as she's been in the hospital this week and now back at home. Please comfort her, heal her, God. Heal Patsy. God, save the lost in our community, God. Those that are driving by the church, God, wondering what's going on, when we're going to be back at church, God. Give us some clear direction, God, on what to do, Father, and bless these as we try to do the best we can. Bless these services, God, as they go out over the internet and are broadcast. God, I'm tired of preaching to a camera this morning. God, I want to be with your people, and I want your will to be done. And I ask you, Father, this morning that you'd help us as we try to bring a message that you've laid on our heart from your precious holy word. Now take, God, your word and bless it, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. In the book of Mark, chapter number 1, we want to begin reading. We want to begin reading in verse number 32. Verse 32 of Mark chapter 1, and the Bible says, "And at even, when the sun did set, they brought unto him all that were diseased and them that were possessed with devils, and all the city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many that were sick of divers diseases, and cast out many devils, and suffered not the devils to speak, because they knew him. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place, and there prayed." And let's stop right there. In verse number 35, I want to bring a message this morning, and I want to preach a message about prayer for just a few minutes. I don't want to be too long. I want to do exactly what God would have us to do, but I want to preach this morning on prayer. And I want to look at, in the Bible, in the Gospels, I want to look at some of the times Jesus went in prayer. And then I want to focus on some things that the Bible shows us and tells us from the epistles about prayer. And I know that sounds long, and that sounds like it's going to take a while, and hopefully it won't. But I want to focus on prayer this morning and look at our Lord and Savior as he was a man of prayer. And the Bible tells us that Jesus went into the temple one time, and he cleaned the temple, and he said, my house would be a house of prayer. And I hope you know today that prayer is the lifeline that the child of God has that keeps us in touch with heaven and keeps us in touch with another world. And I would like to say, and I'd like to be able to stand behind this pulpit and tell you and brag on many days I'd spent all day long in prayer, but I can't do that. And I don't know many people that can. We read about the saints of God in times of old and how they would pray, and God's got us now in this valley. God's got us now in this great trial. And what are we doing? We're asking one another, what are we going to do? I'm going to tell you right now, the number one thing we ought to be doing as a child of God is going regularly to God in prayer and asking him for help and strength in this valley, asking him for help and strength in this storm, asking him to give us guidance and direction, to protect and heal and keep our families safe, and all those things that we pray for. But let me just show you some things. And I like this passage where I read for you in the book of Mark. The Bible said there's something about rising up. The Bible said in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. I want to look at some times in Jesus' life here on earth in his earthly ministry when he went to pray. But I want to talk about this one for just a minute. And I want you to notice some things about Jesus going to prayer. The Bible said, now we read a lot of different times. We read that Jesus went at night to pray, and he went to a mountain alone. And we're going to read some of those times in just a minute. But in this particular instance, the Bible said in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place. There's something about rising up early. There's something about being alone with God at the start of the day. And there's something good about being alone with God at the close of the day in prayer. But I want to just preach and talk about praying for just a few minutes. And I want you to keep a mind of prayer. And I desire your prayers this morning. When we preach on prayer, the devil fights very hard. The devil tries to hinder everything we do about prayer. He tries to hinder our prayer time. He tries to keep us from it. And that's why I believe it's an essential thing to start early in the morning. Now, do I always get up early in the morning and go pray? No. I try to. I try to get up before everybody else does. I try to get my day started. I try to go spend some time with God in prayer. It might be 5 minutes. It might be 15. Sometimes it might be an hour. Not that I'm always praying, but I'm studying and praying and trying to ask God what to do for the day. And some of the greatest times I've ever had with God have been in the morning times. A lot of times, listen, I can remember, and I don't know how it is with y'all, but one of the best things I like about deer hunting, I'm not a great deer hunter. I like to go sit in the calm of the woods. I like to get out and see God's creation. But some of the best times I've ever had with God have been in the early morning hours, just before the sun rises, sitting in a deer stand, alone with God, when the quietness of the world around us just envelops us, and it's just you and God. And you can sit there, and maybe it's not too cold. If it's too cold, that'll probably hinder things. But there's something about being alone with God early and starting the day off with God that I believe God honors and God rewards. And I believe He does the same for ending the day in prayer too. But then the Bible said He went to a solitary place. He was there alone. He went without any distractions around Him. Sometimes when we go pray, we got to get away from everything. I pray a lot of times in the basement, just me. Nobody else around. I pray other times. I pray in my truck going down the road. But I'm talking about finding a specific time and a place to get alone with God and spend some time in prayer in solitary place. I used to like, there was a place that I liked to go and pray. There was a rock up on the hill beside our house, and my grandpa used to go up there and pray, and I'd go up there and pray after we built our house back up here and moved back up into Lumpkin County. I'd go up there quite often, and I would pray, and I enjoyed that time of prayer. But one thing happened and another, and the land sold, and I don't have and haven't had an opportunity to go pray on that hill and on those rocks for several years, and that has hindered me, and that bothered me. Listen, but I began to be burdened a few months ago about having another place, a place to go pray. So in the last few weeks, I've taken my tractor and I found a rock that I liked, and I've moved it down behind the house and got some other rocks piled up behind it, and I've made a place to go pray. I went there and I prayed this morning. I don't go every day. I know I need to, and I need to be more in habit of it, but I want to tell you, there's something about making a solitary place, a specific place, a special place, a prayer ground and a prayer time, that you can be alone with God. And that little old rock, now I've been down there several times to pray. It ain't a little rock. I had to move it with my tractor, but I can see probably where a machine had dug that out of the ground and had piled it up many years ago. It's got some teeth marks, looks like maybe from a bucket on a track hole or something had pulled it out of the ground, and they had left scratches, and they had broken that rock up, but there's moss growing on it, and it's weathered, and it's not sharp, but the weather, and I can see where that time had been spent, and I can imagine now that how spending some time alone with God will knock the rough edges off of us, amen, make us a little bit better subject for the kingdom of heaven. But let's look here in the Word of God at some specific things that God has to say about prayer. And I want you to begin to go with us now and look in the Word of God with me. First of all, I want to take you and I want to show you some things out of the Word of God. Turn with me to the book of Luke for just a minute. In Luke's Gospel, and stay in Luke's Gospel. I'm going to read several places out of Luke's Gospel. And I'm going into Matthew as well. But the Bible says in Luke chapter 11, verse number 1, the Bible says, "And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place." Now, whether this was the same place that he prayed in Mark chapter 1, we don't know. I don't have the answer for that. I didn't study it in that regard. It may be. It doesn't really matter. He was praying in a certain place. But what happens, watch this. "When he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. So I want to just tell you right now, we need some teaching on prayer. If the disciples walking with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ needed some teaching on prayer, then we need to be taught on prayer. And we know the teaching here. Let's read it. And he said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us day by day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So now, hold your finger right there in the book of Luke, and turn also with me back into the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter number 6. We're going to find that there's a similar prayer, and we call this probably, and I say incorrectly, we call this the Lord's Prayer. This was not what the Lord actually prayed. This was the model prayer that he gave for his disciples. And we find it recorded in the book of Matthew chapter number 6 and in the book of Luke chapter number 11 where I read for you. But if you'll study along these lines and begin to look at the events around them, they're two different events and two different time frames. They're not the same occurrence. In other words, Luke's not recording the same thing that Matthew recorded because it's not the same event that's transpiring. Matthew is recording what Jesus taught in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7 called the Sermon on the Mount. Luke records that earlier in his gospel. But what I'm saying is this, Jesus used this model prayer on two different occasions. He used it teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, and then he used it privately with his disciples when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. And there's some things about this model prayer that we ought to take notice of. There's some things about it that we ought to see that stand out. And we don't call it the Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer is recorded in in John chapter number 17, the great prayer of intercession. But he says in verse 7 of Matthew 6, but when you pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do. So now I'm just going to tell you, if all you do is repeat this set of words, that's a vain repetition. There's no power in simply repeating this set of words. Yes, we do that at Mount Zion at Bible school. We have that because we want our children that come to us that may not be in church anywhere to know what we refer to here as the model prayer. We want them to hear that and understand it. We don't want that to be new to them. But if all we pray is some vain repetition. Now, when we're children, our parents will teach us maybe a nighttime prayer. When we're children, maybe our parents will teach us a prayer to pray over our meal. And that's okay to teach that, and we should teach our children those things. But if all we have in our adult life are the repetitions we had as a child, they're vain. There's no power in that. There's no connection to God. There's no relationship that we've built. And that's the thing about prayer. Prayer's not a button to be pushed when we need an emergency answered. Prayer's not an emergency. Press this button, call the Calvary in. Prayer is a relationship that we have with our Heavenly Father. Prayer is a time that we spend to cultivate and grow that relationship. Here in the book of Matthew, he says, pray not. He says, when you pray, use not vain repetitions. For they think they shall be heard for their much speaking. And then he goes on and he goes through the same prayer, a little bit different verbiage, but the model is the same. And he begins like this, and he says, Father, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So one thing we ought to do in prayer is acknowledge who God is, that he's our heavenly Father, and he's high and lifted up. And he's got a kingdom and he's got a will. Notice in verse 10. And the model is asking for God's will to be done. Verse 11, and I like this. In our prayer, we ought to lift God up and acclaim him to be high and holy that he really is. If we're going to have a prayer with God and we're going to spend some time in prayer, it'll be in worshiping him and acknowledging him as King of kings and Lord of lords. But then he says, give us this day our daily bread. We're going to have to acknowledge our total and complete dependence and reliance upon God. The problem with America, the problem in our churches today, is we don't think we need God anymore, so we don't pray. We need God every day. We need God every day. We need God in our life, guiding our directions. We need God every minute of every day. And in our model prayer, we see there's a dependence upon God for the things we need every day. There's an acknowledgement about the will of God. There's an acknowledgement that we've been forgiven, and we ought to forgive as we've been forgiven. But we ought not ever forget. And when we get down on our knees in prayer, we ought not ever forget that we have been forgiven of our sins. If we've been saved, we ought to spend some time in prayer every once in a while just thanking God, not asking Him for things, but just thanking Him that He saved us from our sins and from the penalty of our sins in a place called hell. But then the model prayer closes and he says, "Lead us not into temptation." We ought to ask for protection, because temptation is going to come. It's going to come in different ways. It's going to come in different disguises every day. The devil knows how to distract us. The devil knows how to get our minds off things. I promise you this, when you get down to pray, your mind's going to go in 1,000 different directions. It's going to take some focus. It's going to take some practice. It's going to take some working at it to get alone with God and pray and begin to get some prayers answered in our life. How long has it been since we've had a prayer answered in our life? Boy, that's a tough question, ain't it? That's an humbling question. But let's begin to look now in the Word of God at some times Jesus spent in prayer. Turn with me to the book of Luke, chapter number 6. Luke, chapter number 6. The Bible says in verse number 12 of Luke 6, the Bible says, "And it came to pass in those days that he went out into a mountain to pray, and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called unto him his disciples, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles." We see here in this brief passage of Scripture, in this very moment of time, we see that Jesus spent all night in prayer. Now, listen, I hadn't prayed all night before. You sit down and you say, "I'm going to pray for 15 minutes, and you pray as long as you think you prayed, and you stand up and look at your clock, and it'll be about 2 minutes. Don't spend enough time in prayer. And I'm not telling you you've got to go out and pray all night long for God to hear you. But we ought to be willing to pray as long as it takes to get a prayer through. And I don't always do that. It's difficult. I know it is. I understand. That can be a challenge. But Jesus spent all night in prayer. The Bible says he went out into a mountain. Again, we see him in a solitary place. But here's what I want you to notice. After that, the Bible said Jesus, when it was day, he called unto him his disciples, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles. I want to tell you something. As we look at the life of Jesus in prayer, and there are other times, I'm going to just focus on a few of these. But focusing on just a few of them, I want you to know that Jesus gives us an example that there's prayer time before there's work to be done. Here he had a work, he had a task he was going to complete. He was going to call 12 apostles. He was going to select out of all his followers 12 that would be named apostles. But before he did that, Jesus spent all night in prayer. Before there's a work to do, we ought to spend some time in prayer preparing for that work. We ought to spend some time in prayer if we're a teacher before we teach, if we're a preacher before we preach, if we're a singer before we sing. We ought to spend some time in prayer. I hope everybody here, and I know that there are several people here trying to make this service work and trying to make the broadcast work. We ought to spend some time in prayer before we try to come together and do any work for God. The preacher ought to be a man of prayer. The teacher ought to be a man of prayer. Listen, and if we're not, then now's the time to start. Because Jesus shows us when there's a work to do, there's prayer to be prayed and to be made first. Amen. Spending time alone with God in prayer. Turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter number 14. Matthew chapter 14, I used this the other day. We talked about in the storms the other day, but I want to look at something with you. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 14, verse number 22, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him into the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up to a mountain apart to pray. And when evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And if you go on and you study that, they were there in the storm all night long before Jesus comes to them walking on the water. What I see in this is that Jesus has given us example that we ought to pray when we see the storms coming. We ought to pray when we see storms coming. We pray before we go to work and do God's work, but we ought to pray when we see a storm coming. And right now, we see a storm before us, don't we? Right now, we're in the midst of a storm called this coronavirus, the epidemic or pandemic that's sweeping the globe. And listen, I don't believe everything I hear about it. I try to believe what the Bible gives us. The Bible doesn't mention coronavirus. I know that. But the Bible knows, says this, "This know also in the last days perilous times shall come, dangerous times, wicked times." And as we see the storm clouds rising, as we see things, every time you turn on the news, you're going to hear something different about this corona, this pandemic. You cannot believe everything that the news is telling you, because as I said earlier, and people are going to get mad over this, I won't say 90%, but I'll say a great majority of what we're hearing on the news about this is being driven politically. I'd say as much political as there is medical is driving the information that we're hearing right now. So the best thing we can do is turn off the tube and turn on to God, amen, and spend some time in prayer as Jesus did when he saw the storm was coming. And preacher, I can't always see that there's storms coming in my life. No, but if we'll spend and be a man and or a woman of prayer, then when the storm gets there, praying will be easier. This is the night that the storm came. Jesus was on the mountain. They were down on the sea in the ship. Jesus didn't go weeks. He'd already been praying for them. I understand that. But in the example that he gives, he's on a mountain praying and there in the storm. We ought to pray when we see the storm coming. Turn with me to the book of Luke, chapter number 9. Luke, chapter number 9. Verse number 28, the Bible says, "And it came to pass about And 8 days after these sayings, he took Peter and John and James and went up to a mountain to pray. And as he prayed, the fashion of his countenance was altered, and his raiment was white and glistening. And behold, there talked with him two men, which were Moses and Elias, who appeared in glory and spake of his decease, which he should accomplish at Jerusalem." This is the account that we call the transfiguration. The word transfiguration means a change. This is an account that we have in Luke's gospel. It's also recorded for us in the book of Matthew and maybe Mark. I didn't look at Mark to see if it was recorded there. But Matthew and Luke both record the transfiguration of Jesus Christ when he goes up into a mountain and he takes Peter, James, and John with him. And there he prays. I want you to understand something. He prays, and the Bible says the fashion of his countenance was altered. What happened? I can tell you this, he didn't change into any different body, but the glory that he had in heaven before he came to earth was embodied in his earthly body that was before him. He was clothed with glory and honor. Listen, the Bible says the Bible said here that a cloud, or it says it in Matthew, I believe it is, that a cloud enveloped them. In verse 34 it says, "As they feared, as they entered in the cloud, and there came a voice out of the cloud saying, 'This is my beloved son, hear him.'" Listen, I want you to know something. It was a time of prayer in Jesus' life. I'm telling you, Jesus has given us a model. I'm not saying we're going to be transfigured. I'm not saying we're going to change. But I'm telling you right now, we ought to pray before we go to work. We ought to pray when we see the storm coming. And we ought to pray to have worship with God. If we're going to have worship with him, and we're going to see, excuse me, we're going to see the glory of God descending. I mean, we're going to see the glory of God in our life. It's going to be when we pray. I preached last Sunday on opening the windows of heaven. Do you know how the windows of heaven will be opened in your soul for a blessing? It'll be through prayer. I've got Bible to back that up. I've got Bible that I can show you where that happens. Turn with me in the book of Luke. Let me find it here. I want to look at Luke's account of the baptism of Jesus Christ. It's found for us in the book of Luke, chapter number 3. In the book of Luke, chapter number 3, verse number 21, the Bible says, "Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus, also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened." A lot of times we just preach that Jesus was baptized and the heavens were opened and the Spirit of God descended like a dove on him. But we missed a step. We don't always read Luke's account of this. The Bible says Jesus was baptized and was praying, and the heaven was opened. If you want to open the windows of heaven, it'll be through prayer. If you want to open up the glory of God in your soul, it will be through prayer. Listen, so we see in Jesus' life that he prayed when he had a work to do. He prayed when the storms were coming. He prayed to have the windows of heaven, glory, opened into his soul. Yes, he was the Son of God, but he was giving us an example that praying would open up heaven for us. Here the disciples were on the mountain. The cloud came and enveloped them. They heard the voice in the cloud, "This is my beloved Son. Hear him." That same thing happened similarly when he was baptized. The heavens opened. The dove descended. "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Listen, if we want heaven and we want glory in our life, the way to it is through prayer. The way to get to it is through prayer. Are we praying enough? No. No, I can say we don't pray enough because I know I don't pray enough. Look what the Bible has to say for us in the book of Luke, chapter number 18. This is Jesus speaking. Jesus is speaking right here. "And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint." I've never fainted. I've come close. I've never known that I've completely passed out, fainted. Other people have. I'm not going to make fun, not saying anything against that. The word faint here means to be discouraged. The word faint here means to back off. In other words, he said men ought always to pray and not to faint. And then he tells them a parable about a woman who goes to an unjust judge. Listen to me. And this woman goes to this unjust judge to have some things, to have an adversary avenged. And the unjust judge would not hear her and would not regard what she had to say. But the Bible said because she kept troubling him, because she kept coming to him and was persistent, that this unjust judge took action and heeded to her request. This is an unjust judge. He says in verse number 4, "Though I fear not God nor regard man." But now I'm not telling you to go to an unjust judge. I'm telling you to go to the just God of heaven. And if the just, unjust judge can be troubled into action, then the just God of heaven, who is our heavenly Father if we've been saved, and who wants to hear from us, and who has a desire to have a relationship with us, and tells us we ought always to pray and not to faint, not to be discouraged. In this time of discouragement, we ought to be more in tune with heaven right now than we've ever been in our life. We ought to be more in tune with heaven right now through prayer than we've ever seen a time in our life to do it. We've never seen anything like this in our lifetime. And here we are trying to follow God and do the best we can. Are we spending enough time with God in prayer? Are we discouraged? Are we fainting? Are we ready to back off? Just say it's not worth the trouble. It's a lot of trouble for everybody to come up here on Sunday and try to get this broadcast ready, but it's worth every minute. It's a lot of trouble to try to maybe set up and have a drive-in service next week, but it's worth every minute. And I'll do it if it can get God's people together, and it'll strengthen you. Men ought always to pray and not to faint. Now I'm going to close in just a minute, But I want to look at some other places in the Word of God before we close. Now we've looked at the life of Jesus. We've looked at Jesus' earthly ministry. We've taken a few snapshots of time and focused on just a few instances in time of Jesus praying. Jesus was a man of prayer. I didn't even touch on the great intercessory prayer that he prayed the night before he was crucified in the Garden of Eden there in John chapter number 17. Where he says, I pray not for these alone, but for everybody that believe on me through their word. Listen, he prayed for me, he prayed for you. If we believed on Jesus Christ through the work and the word of the apostles as they penned it down and were obedient to the will of God and penned down the holy scriptures for us, we read those holy inspired scriptures that they were so faithful to pen down and do the work of God, and we were blessed through the prayer of Jesus Christ there in the garden as he prayed and he asked his disciples to watch with me for 1 hour, and they went to sleep. Listen, they went to sleep as Jesus was praying. Listen, and he come back and he scolded them a little bit and said, could you not watch with me 1 hour? And he goes back and he prays again. He comes back and he finds them asleep. And he goes back and he prays the third time. And he comes back and they're asleep. And he says, sleep on, because you're going to need it. We need to spend some time with God in prayer. It'd be all right. And listen, you say, well, preacher, I fell asleep praying. Ain't nothing wrong with that. No better thing to do, go fall asleep reading your Bible and praying. Well, preacher, I'm embarrassed. I fall asleep. Well, are you embarrassed when you fall asleep watching TV? Don't be embarrassed falling asleep praying. Don't be embarrassed falling asleep reading your Bible. At least you were doing something for God. Wake up and do it again. Yeah, keep on with it. But let's look here a little bit further in the Word of God. Let's go into the epistles and now and see what direction God has for us in the New Testament age. We've seen the life of Jesus, our model. We've seen the model prayer. We've seen Jesus, our teacher, giving us an example of prayer. In the book of Romans chapter 12, verse number 12, the Bible says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Reference in my Bible points right back to Luke chapter 18, verse number 1, about praying and fainting not. But he says here, Paul writing to the church at Rome, he said, to rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing in prayer. How many of us in the last 5 weeks that we've been doing this, we've been quarantined or we've been out of school since March the 13th. This is the fifth Sunday, counting the fifth Sunday in March, that we've done live feed recordings here from the church without a congregation. The last time we were in church, listen to me, the last time we gathered together in church was the third Sunday night in the month of March. We had a youth service. And in that service, have you thought about this? The last time we were gathered together in this building, two precious young girls got saved. What was God doing? What was God doing? He was calming their fears before the storm came. He was calming them. He was giving them hope. He was rejoicing. He was giving them something to hold on to. He was giving them hope. And now we look back at that, and in this tribulation of time that we're in this time of trial, I didn't say we were in the period of, well, I didn't say we're in the great tribulation or the tribulation period, but we are in a time of tribulation. We are in a time of trouble. We're in a time like we've never seen. Jesus tells us, or Paul writes and tells us to be patient and to continue in prayer. Well, preacher, nothing's changing. I'm ready to quit praying. Listen, you can't give up on praying. The gentleman that held the office of president, and I won't even call him the president because I don't have any respect for the man at all, but the one that was president before we've got right now, there was something happened, a shooting happened in one of the western states, some mass murder and killing, and that man that was holding the office of president said, it doesn't look like prayer is working. Well, his prayers probably weren't. But our prayers, the prayer of faith, God will hear. The prayer of faith, God will answer. The prayer of faith that comes before God from his children, he will hear. He may not always answer the way that we like, but he tells us to continue instant in prayer. Turn with me to the book of Ephesians chapter number 6. Ephesians chapter number 6. I'm getting ready to close, so you just bear with me for another minute. Ephesians chapter number 6. I want to look in verse number 18. The Bible says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. Paul writes to the church at Ephesus in his benediction here, in his closing. He says, praying with prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Can you pray in yourself? No, absolutely not. But you can pray in the Spirit. And if you'll let the Spirit of God, and the Bible tells us that there are times, and I've been there a time or two, that when we would pray, we would be in such agony, we didn't even know any words to say, but the connection we had with heaven was as strong as it ever has been. And that's the time when the Spirit is making intercession for you and I. Have you ever been in such agony that the Spirit was praying for you? That the Holy Spirit of God that dwells in you was making your request known to God. I've been there a time or two. I've been there a few times in my life when I couldn't even pray. I couldn't even make words come out of my mouth. But I knew I was in tune with heaven, and I knew I was connected to God. And I thank God today that in times of great distress, but praying with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit and watching thereunto with all perseverance, it's time to watch and pray. It's time to watch and pray. One more verse, and then I'll close. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, the Bible says this in verse 17, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. What are we supposed to do? How can you pray without ceasing? How can you ever, is he telling us that we quit our jobs? Is he telling us that we just give up everything and all we do is spend every minute of every day, morning, night, noon, in prayer? No, he's telling us that we go with a prayerful attitude. We go with an attitude of prayer on our heart. Listen, have you ever been driving down the road and you look over and you see a house and you know who lives there and God says, pray for them? Listen, God says you need to pray for them. When do you pray for them? Pray for them right then. What I found in life, the best thing to do, somebody comes up to me and says, will you pray for me? The best thing I can do is bow my head right then and whisper a prayer to God for that person and that request. Trying my best to remember it days, weeks later on. Sometimes we do, sometimes we forget them, and God will bring them back to our mind. But when somebody says, pray for me, we ought to be instant in prayer right then. As we go down the road and we look across and we see a house of somebody, and maybe we know they're in need. Maybe we know they're going through a battle of cancer. Maybe we know they're fighting some disease. Maybe we know that they're having this difficulty or that difficulty, or their family's in trouble. Listen, what we ought to do is as we ride by, listen, I used to do it going to work. I'd come from the house going to Cleveland, and I'd pass by many members' homes, and I'd go by. And as I'm going down the road, I'd say, Lord, remember this one. Lord, remember that one. Lord, be with this need. Lord, be. Listen, some of the greatest times in prayer have been when we just took an attitude, not when we could bow our head, couldn't close my eyes driving, but he says pray without ceasing. It's to have an attitude of prayer about us so that we can pray when the need arises. We can pray when the need arises. There's one place as they come to the instruments and get ready to sing. There's a place in the Old Testament that I want to call your attention to, and then I'm going to close. I said I'd be in the New Testament. This one moves my heart. In 1 Samuel chapter number 12, we find that Samuel's going to reprove the people because they had sinned. In 1 Samuel chapter number 12, he says in verse number 21, and turn ye not aside, for then should ye go after vain things which cannot profit nor deliver, for they are vain. For the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it hath pleased the Lord to make you his people. Moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. But I will teach you the good and the right way. Old Samuel, the old prophet, the man of God, said it'd be a sin to cease praying for you. Listen, I want to lift you up this morning. I want to lift Mount Zion Church up. My members, I miss you this morning. I love you. And I don't have a sermon written down, just had a few Bible references written down. But I want to close in prayer before they sing. So bow your head with us as we pray. Heavenly Father, take these few words we've tried to share with your people. God, take these few thoughts, God, that we've tried to leave. and tried to be a man of God of prayer. Lord, help us, I pray, to be more prayerful. Help us to be more in tune with you in prayer, Heavenly Father. God, I pray today for the needs of Mount Zion Church. I pray for the needs of our country. You said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. God, the wicked aren't seeking you. The wicked aren't turning, God. It's going to take your people praying and turning and repenting. God, help us today to be people of prayer. God, I believe prayer works, and I believe prayer will make a difference in this time in our country. I believe prayer, God, will keep this coronavirus at bay. I believe prayer, Heavenly Father, will open the doors of our churches back up and allow us to come back in here and worship you. Help us, God, to do your will. Give us guidance and direction. In Jesus' holy and righteous name, I humbly pray. Amen.